Well, thank you, Paul, for this friendly introduction. Welcome, everyone, to an exercise in valuing nature. And to start this off, my colleague Anna Svensson, who is also in this audience, a participant of our campus experience, experiment, suggested that we should do this as an auction. So auctioning off some precious nature that I brought with me here. I start with that full glass of water, Berlin tap water, fresh from the tap. Highly processed, of course, purified, first-rate drinking water. And I think 50 euro cents is an adequate price, if not a bargain. Who would be willing to offer that? Yeah, I see some hands raised. Do I hear 1 euro for it? Don't be shy. And mark my words, I mean, in other parts of the world, people would be happy to have that as their daily freshwater ration. The oceans are going to hell, so this is really a bargain and a good investment. You might also think of this city being able to actually flush their toilets with this kind of water. Cheers. So that is sold to the gentleman in the black shirt over there for 4 euros. Thank you very much. Then we turn to this glass of Berlin air. You know, everyone knows there's something very special about the Berliner Luft, and here we have it. I think a euro as a starting bid is a generous offer, really, that you cannot decline. Anyone willing to pay for that? Well, we can think about that. So what did I just hear? That's for free, actually. Well, for now. Who knows if not very soon, if air pollution further increases, this might become very, very costly. And then you might be happy to have that in your kitchen cabinet, actually, to have this around. And be able to breathe. So this is sold to the lady in the red shirt over there, thank you, for 5 euros. And then I brought this topsoil, freshly dug out from the park at the HKW outside. I think 2 euros is a very good offer for that. Who is willing to pay that? We see some hands over there. Do I hear more? Do I hear 3? Yes, wonderful. Do I hear 4? I mean, what was that? This is basically there in abundance. Did I hear that right? There's no shortage of that kind of mud and dirt and stone. Well, I'm not sure about that. Think about this as a potential. Think about the potential of this. And see the blossoming gardens. Imagine Berlin without the Tiergarten outside. Especially when climate change will become worse, also for the northern regions. And that park will not bring relief in a city of Berlin, a heat island like that big city. You might be very happy to have that to cultivate. So I think 5 euros is really a discount, if you think of it. You could think of it as a discount. You pay cheap, you buy it cheap now, consume, who cares about the future anyway? Or you can look at it as an investment and cultivate this and garden it. And perhaps I can offer you that set here, really, the nature set. For 10 euros, I think really this is a wonderful bargain. 10 euros a do-it-yourself ecosphere kit. That could be seen as an investment because it might provide something that you don't even know now about what it will be that will sustain your life at some point. That is all in here when this does its microbial thing here, if you put it all together. Sold for 20 euros to the gentleman in the yellow shirt over there. Thank you very much. And welcome again to our exercise in valuing nature. You've seen that it's not easy to put a value on bits of nature as I've brought them in here. There's many ways that we can place a value on nature, a spiritual value, think of God's creation and whatnot. Aesthetic values of beautiful sceneries and landscapes, emotional values, the attachments that we have to the places we know and love. Symbolic values pointing to or referring, symbolizing a community, a region, a city, a nation. Recreational values, I guess many people are actually willing to pay a lot for this, for the opportunity to spend time in nature or go to a nature park or a zoo or a garden. And then there is the economic value that seems by now one of the most prominent ways, the most common and maybe the most unquestioned ways of placing a value on nature. And our question here in our seminar is, what do we value and how do we want to do this? How do we want to evaluate? So often we understand value in the economic sense. The price tag that we put on a nature that has been turned into a resource or is turned into a resource in that same moment of pricing it. And this can be really, really useful. This way we can actually represent, find an adequate measure of the costs and the benefits of extracting nature as a resource, of consuming it, of recycling it, or of substituting it if it's gone by monetary or technological means. So we have accounting tools at hand, and they have become common instruments to balance our human-nature relationships. Here, for instance, we can point to the polluter-pays principle, or the carbon offset schemes for using nature not as a resource, but as a sink, and both source and sink can be prized for the greater ecological good, in a way. This is also problematic, however, and the little exercise here perhaps demonstrated some of this, the problems of understanding value economically. Problematic is that this understanding involves and perhaps also leads to an anthropocentric and even instrumental view on nature as a source for humans, primarily for humans and their needs and their well-being, and completely discarding what a glass of soil might do in other ways and for other species that are not us. So who is able to define and then to access and even exploit a resource? And is accounting, or are accounting adequate tools to understand and control resource use? These are some questions that we will address. This is a a picture that I like very much. It's from the from a 2010 ad, a web campaign by a Swiss think tank called Wire. And it's in German. It reads, "Ginge die Natur an die Börse, wäre sie der wertvollste Börsengang aller Zeiten," which translates roughly to, "If nature went public, it would be the most valuable stock market flotation of all times." So the what is promoted here, the message being promoted is Nachhaltigkeit braucht Märkte, sustainability needs markets. This has become a common idea, a common belief, that if we want to operate sustainably in the world, we need to do it through capital market systems. There's, of course, several readings to this picture, and especially here the image of the empty carts and what that would mean. And I read at least two here, two ways of interpretation. One is pointing to the usefulness of the metrics. The shopping carts will remain empty eventually because humans have overstretched their use of environment. So there's nothing to buy then anymore at some point. And the other reading, perhaps, is the reading of the exchange system being the problematic issue that is at stake here. So we could also read this image as the shopping carts of some people will remain empty because the value system allocates nature as we now allocate, well, basically all consumer goods to the richest. So the question is, of course, also whether the market system is the adequate system to address issues of sustainable human-nature interaction. Because the market system is, well, possibly the most unequal exchange system available. So the question that our seminar raises is the question, should we rely on such evaluation and exchange systems, market exchange systems, to break even with anthropogenic environmental change? And is perhaps these exchange systems, do they give or pose the opportunity to integrate use of the commons and the debate about the commons into this kind of balancing that we're doing? Commons as being, well, part of some of these that I've presented here. The air is still a commons, but we don't know for how long it is. Water, oceans are basically territorialized entirely, and then we have other commons like common resources, common intellectual resources, knowledge and educational resources that are commons, and how do we want to share these? Is there a means to count and inventory what we have without producing the same old accounts? Can we come up with new accounts beyond the economic balance sheet? We think this is an Anthropocene question because the Anthropocene is, of course, not just a description, a descriptive term describing the geological or biospheric age of humankind, but it's also a normative term and concept that challenges us to reflect on the conditions and on the consequences of the state that we think we're now in. So it's a challenge and it's a possibility, and we heard yesterday about science and the sciences and knowledge being part of the problem, but it will also be part of the solution. It must be. So we are able and we are forced to take a position in this problem of valuing nature beyond the vital balance sheet. And here I hand over to my colleague Ioan.
Thank you, Sabine.
And listen from here. Thanks.
Well, it's exactly about that. We are trying to take make an option. And I will use the time I have for this presentation to give you a slight idea about what the students are going to be implicated in during our session. I will use also a series of keywords to fuel the discussion today, but the subject as such is probably much beyond the time allocated to this presentation. So, idea is to try to think of Anthropocene as a cultural landscape. In that landscape, we are today in what we could call the triumphant Anthropocene. We are trying to see whether we can go to the slow Anthropocene. Now, for that, we need a kind of cultural revolution. To make sure that we can understand the extent of that revolution, I took the risk to discuss with the students a kind of comparative approach to the way biosphere, ecosystems, and the societies are organized. I will use for today only the example of the ecosystem, and I will try, because I think that's important if you want to do a cultural revolution, to start the revolution with talking the same language as the one you want to turn down by the revolution. So the terms, we will look at the ecosystem through a series of economic terms. Now, I'm not an economist, so I might make mistakes, but that's why we are here. Capital. The natural capital is something that I can also not exclusively summarize as being the net primary production. This is photosynthesis, etc., etc. Now, you have to know that nature is generous with its capital in the sense that it takes roughly 50% of the profit it makes to regenerate that capital. So keep this in mind. Now, ecosystems function in cycles, rhythms, from which we take our services. It also makes use of competition. It's interesting to think of competition in nature because there is an extremely big gap between the way nature makes competition and the way our societies make and use competition. Competition in nature is something that corresponds to a kind of real-time taxation system. That's essentially the food networks. They represent layers of taxation because they are taxed according to energy considerations, to the fact that in the system there is no waste, and the end result of the system necessitates diversity. So, all in all, if I can summarize very briefly this, the ecosystem is a capital context in which there are no deficits or debts produced, and in general, unless there are more exceptionally catastrophes, they produce an ecological reserve, like a bank. Now, also, in the nature, you find a kind of equality between those who participate to the system. So, all in all, the system is resilient, is complex, and is productive. Now, if you take this and put in the place of ecosystem the human, human society, and you look at all these components, you will roughly obtain an upside-down picture. Just take a few examples. In the capital, I will not go into physical, human, financial. Our cycles are actually straight lines, one direction, no cycles, very rarely. our rhythms are high-tech, extremely short cycles, extremely nervous behaviors in a kind of blind competition system that actually has invented a context in which tax is delayed or actually not paid to Mother Nature. All in all, this generates a system with low efficiency in energy, with a lot of waste, and if I look at the social dimension, we have a kind of biodiversity, rich and poor. The system runs on deficit, on debt, and I summarize this in the next slide. I only wanted to add to the previous picture the fact that the cultural background in which these two contrasting and conflicting organization systems occur is actually based on our side on immoderation, beyond measure, so we can use this for our valuing system. We are in a beyond measure condition, and forcings. We generally force everything that comes across our route. So the biosphere, no depth, is a system with a high resilience, and if you put it to a stress test, a real stress test, usually you reduce the resilience, but it stays roughly resilient. With our societies that produce a triple dumping, social, environmental, fiscal, it's a great source of debt. Now, that system is vulnerable, and if you put it to a stress test, then you end up with a very vulnerable or a collapse. So, the idea there is, if now you put in competition Mother Nature with our societies, what's the end result? My suspicion is that the social systems are much more vulnerable than the natural system. So the end product of whatever outcome is of business as usual is that I think the first to suffer are our social systems. That's the hypothesis on which we will build the seminar. What evidence we have about these kind of situations? There are the tools we are going to develop and discuss with the students. I give you just a rough example. This is the ecological footprint, translated as biocapacity. What we do with that biocapacity, but it takes time because of the resilience of nature, to shrink it steadily. I just remind you that the overshoot day is earlier every year, so that's our debt deficit system. You can also look into another set of indicators that are here called net landscape ecological potential, developed by the European Environmental Agency, where you can see the countries in Europe according to that indicator, which actually measures the quality of the stock, habitat, species, etc. And you see that most of the European countries are increasing their deficit decade by decade. The few ones, Germany is a kind of a steady state level, and there are a few exceptions there, but the general trend is to exhaust the natural capital. Now, what's the timing of these processes? I have two examples here. One is from Barnowski paper, in which you look at the rate at which we degrade the ecosystems. In light green, you have the percentage of lightly affected ecosystems. In dark green, you have the percentage of ecosystems that have been seriously damaged by humans. Now, what you see there, it starts in 1700 and goes up to the medium remote future. So what you see here as most interesting is that we have this great acceleration in the alteration of the ecosystems from the 50s to now, and this is pretty tightly bound also to demography. Now, what the paper message is that we are roughly using today 40% of that capacity. In other words, and that's another indicator we are going to discuss during the session, is human appropriation of net primary production. So human appropriation of the natural capital is roughly that, 40%. The message of those scientists is that we should not go beyond 50% of that capacity. Why? Because I told you, Mother Nature needs something, invests something like 50% of its capital to regenerate it. So if what they say is true, then we will probably start to have big problems in 10 years' time. That's the timing. 10 years' time. Who says less? In the same direction, but I will not, because I think this is roughly known. So this is the extension of limits to growth. Turner in Australia prolonged the initial curves of the 12 scenarios. Guess which scenario fits to the extension of the curves? Business as usual. And this is true for most of the indicators: death rate, birth rate, services per capita, food per capita, etc. What's the message? The message is that these curves all change shape around 2030, latest. How a world looks would look if this is true? It would be something that has nothing to do with the life standards of today, in the Western world, I mean. So, the objective of our conversation during the course and the seminars is to think of a depth cultural revolution approach. So the objective of our student work is to see how can we imagine building a social and ecosystemic resilient society or societies. That means no socio-ecosystemic depth that needs to be based on a series of values, could be constraints also. And I put them in small, in capital letters, but it is the most important message I have for this seminar. Social justice, environmental responsibility, cultural acceptance. Now, this is easy to say, but if you want to transit from business as usual to circa, that's a bloody operation. That it will be extremely difficult, because the slow Anthropocene, if this is going to happen, will be frugal, self-supporting societies for most of the economic and human activity parameters, and it will have to challenge property rights, etc., etc. The question is, if the 10 years delay is true, what will be the cost to switch from triumphant to slow Anthropocene in 10 years? So I did, and I used it as an examination subject with my students. And this transition has been calibrated through two hypotheses. I don't dare to present you the third, because that's absolutely difficult to accept. Knowing the life standards we have today. So hypothesis one is that we live in a territory where the available resources can match vital needs and wants. That means the carrying capacity of that territory is at equilibrium. Now, how many places on Earth are that are in that situation? Not many. I listed a few there. Hypothesis two was that we live in a territory where the available resources are actually allowing to provide the vital needs, but not necessarily the wants. So the carrying capacity of that area with the living standards of today is larger than the available resources. And these are the great majority of the countries. So with the students, we'll try to simulate those. What would be the necessary behaviors and activities and governance that can lead and solve positively that situation? Those situations, those hypotheses. Why are we entitled to do that? Well, I think because it's already in the book, United States book. And that cultural revolution, which is written somewhere, doesn't seem to take place anywhere on the world, in the world. All persons have the right to a secure, healthy, and ecologically sound environment. This right and other human rights, including civil, cultural, economic, political, are universal, interdependent, and indivisible. This answers my triangulation: social justice, environmental responsibility, cultural acceptance. So that's why we do those evaluations. Now, all these do not tell about duties. Well, my duty, our duty, is to do those simulations, to check if we stand up with the rights. So, as a case study, we took Berlin and wanted to figure out how Berlin matches this picture. Who does what in Berlin to make that city fit the three values we mentioned here? So I will not go into many details because I think that would be an interesting opportunity for discussion. We are not Berliners, so we had the chance to mobilize here the real Berliner experts, like we have here Herbert Lohner from the Friends of the Earth, the Bund, who knows a lot about Berlin and can tell us the true story. Now, if you look at the internet and you try to see what Berlin looks like in rankings, you can find this. Top 10 smart cities, these are the criteria. Number 6. But then if you read the comments, you realize that this is completely fake classification. So are most of the data that we find on the internet really representing something? So that's one question the students will look, but they will look into data available on the websites of the city, like the Senate, with a Berlin Environmental Atlas. There is a very interesting project at the Technische Universität in Berlin, working on strategic planning and political decision support. Greening Berlin, a very interesting book by Jens Lachmund. I will come back to that in a minute. The Bund itself is doing a number of interesting initiatives, and you have Agenda 21 in Berlin, etc., etc. The trouble from the one who comes from outside and looks on those spots is that what you get are fragmentary informations. Looks like the system doesn't want you to get a real picture. You can find a lot of water on the air, etc., but not the big picture. Unfortunately, this is not true for the simple reason that if you are a Berliner and if you have your good sources, then you can come up with an information which is the Umwelt und Mensch Information Dienst, Special Issue 2, Environmental Justice. Herbert can tell you about this, but there are very, very interesting maps and information in there. Why this type of information is needed is because if you read Jens Lachmund's conclusions about the greening Berlin, that gives you something like this. There is a Nature Conservation Act from 1979, and the result of a political and all shareholders' contribution to the implementation of the Act has come to the following conclusion. Since the late 70s, the trajectory of mitigation policy in Berlin was the constant drift from the restriction of developmental projects that are not sustainable to a flexible compensation only loosely connected with the original projects. So what that means? That means there is an erosion in the regulation. By what? By flexibilization. That reminds you probably of economic standards and business as usual, and lack of implementation. This lack of this flexibilization actually is also very suspiciously subversive because it tends to substitute biotope protection with recreation planning, for instance, etc., etc. So this is the stand in the city of Berlin, and this is what we are going to discuss with the students and see how far we can get. But from the outsider that tries to grasp an idea where Berlin stands in his trajectory to sustainability, there is no way to get the big picture. All right, having said that, I think Sabine is ready to conclude.
Okay, thanks. Am I on? Yeah, I am. So to conclude the question again, can we evaluate the baseline of a self-sufficient Berlin in terms of humans and nature's vital needs? for a sustainable social ecological transition. And we identify the following challenges. So what to count in, and how can we overcome basically the counting in of very fragmented sort of bits of resources that through indicator systems are basically listed but never really brought together in any meaningful sense. How can we count what to count? What matters here? People, land, water, energy, emissions. How does that picture emerge? How can we make a meaningful picture emerge? And how can we count looking at the different tools available assessment tools, accounting approaches of material flow analyses, indicator systems, the footprint, the debt analyses, and so on. And the question of balance that Ioan so nicely addressed is a no-debt society possible? Is it efficient? Is it sufficient? Will it be sufficient? Will it be sufficient to build on the equivalence of natural capital and financial capital in this? And what kind of currency do we propose? Can we imagine? Are there other forms of currencies available beyond the capital metaphor that is long, not a metaphor any longer, but basically has already absorbed all of nature, it seems. So which kind of exchange systems do we want to agree on? Thank you very much for your attention.